it's time for Toker Talk Radio, the voice of the marijuana nation.
What are you people? On dope?
Where you can toke.
I inhale frequently.
Or you can talk.
I experimented with marijuana and didn't inhale.
Or you can toke and talk.
10 federal criminal penalties for possession of up to 1 ounce of marijuana.
While we talk about toke on Toker Talk Radio.
So by the way, when it comes to pot, you know, if you're 40 years old, you live in a log cabin in Oregon, you got 12 giant pot plants in your backyard, have a ball.
Live from beautiful Portland, Oregon at Rolla J Studios.
Hey, this is great.
Freedom, yes, freedom, cannabis.
Plus your calls live at 971-533-7111.
They're walking on their pants with their cap on backwards, listening to the Enema Man and Snoopy Snoopy Poop Dog.
What's to keep somebody from getting all potted up on weed and then getting behind the wheel?
Gateway theory doesn't work. It's a reality.
Holland, is it real? Don't tease me.
We're locking up people that take a couple of puffs of marijuana, and the next thing you know, they got 10 years.
And now, here's your host, the guru of ganja graphics, the sultan of sativa statistics, and the worst nightmare of a reefer mad prohibitionist. A polite, perspicacious, productive pothead with a propensity for PowerPoint. Radical Russ Belleville.
Continuing to monitor and respond to the situation as it unfolds. I've directed the full resources of the federal government to help state and local authorities protect our people, increase security around the United States as necessary, and investigate what happened. The American people will say a prayer for Boston tonight, and Michelle and I send our deepest thoughts and prayers to the families of the victims in the wake of this senseless loss. We don't yet have all the answers. But we do know that multiple people have been wounded, some gravely, in explosions at the Boston Marathon. I've spoken to FBI Director Mueller and Secretary of Homeland Security Napolitano, and they're mobilizing the appropriate resources to investigate and to respond. I've updated leaders of Congress in both parties, and we reaffirm that on days like this there are no Republicans or Democrats. We are Americans, united in concern for our fellow citizens. I've also spoken with Governor Patrick and Mayor Menino and made it clear that they have every single federal resource necessary to care for the victims and counsel the families. And above all, I made clear to them that all Americans stand with the people of Boston. Boston police, firefighters, and first responders, as well as the National Guard, responded heroically and continue to do so as we speak. It's a reminder that so many Americans serve and sacrifice on our behalf every single day without regard to their own safety in dangerous and difficult circumstances. And we salute all those who assisted in responding so quickly and professionally to this tragedy. We still do not know who did this or why. And people shouldn't jump to conclusions before we have all the facts. But make no mistake, we will get to the bottom of this, and we will find out who did this. We'll find out why they did this. Any responsible individuals, any responsible groups will feel the full weight of justice. Today is a holiday in Massachusetts, Patriots Day. It's a day that celebrates the free and fiercely independent spirit that this great American city of Boston has reflected from the earliest days of our nation. And it's a day that draws the world to Boston's streets in a spirit of friendly competition. Boston is a tough and resilient town. So are its people. I'm supremely confident that Bostonians will pull together, take care of each other, and move forward as one proud city. And as they do, the American people will be with them every single step of the way. You should anticipate that as we get more information, our teams will provide you briefings. We're still in the investigation stage at this point, but I just want to reiterate, we will find out who did this, and we will hold them accountable. Thank you very much.
And President Obama speaking earlier today on the bombings at the Boston Marathon. Two explosive devices detonated just about an hour or so ago. The latest reports that I am getting from CNN show two killed, over 100 injured, 110, at least 110 injured. One of the dead is an 8-year-old child. And, you know, trying to react to something like this, trying to make any sense of this is, you know, impossible that someone would, you know, purposefully try to do something like this for whatever reasons they might have. Insane as they are, the words kind of fail when you want to talk about something like this, when something like this happens. And what I hope mostly is that we respond to this in a sober and reasonable way. Too often, I think, in America, we, and our media has something to do with this, too often we have a tendency to try to fit the actions and try to fit the narrative of the day into pre-built frames. You know, there's already people in the chat rooms and on the comment boards around the net now. You know, some that are blaming, oh, it's Muslim terrorists. Oh, and there's some that are saying, oh, it's, you know, white right-wing extremism, or we don't even know. We don't know what caused this yet. And yet people quickly want to try to put it into their nice little box of, you know, we hate them or they hate us or it's for our freedoms or whatever it might be. And not thinking through what it is that we know. And this is something, you know, going back to 9/11 and everything that we dealt with in the first decade of this century, treating terrorism as warfare when it's really crime. And we have ways of dealing with crime. And we should use those. We should use our domestic law enforcement. We shouldn't be turning this into anything bigger than what it is before we know all of the details. We're going to open the phone lines here at 971-533-7111 if you want to call in and talk about this or a marijuana topic for that matter. It's hard for me not to talk about breaking news when it's happening and when it's this big. So we've got some marijuana stories on tap though as well. So stick around. Toker Talk Radio.
The Russ Belville Show is blogging and podcasting daily at RadicalRuss.com.
What's happening, funky brothers and soul sisters? This is Big Daddy, and I want you to win a t-shirt courtesy of the Funky Roller Rink and 420radio.org. Just tune into the Funky Roller Rink this week and keep track of all the hip-hop tunes and sample my Funk 3, baby. Music make you move, 'cause you can dig the groove. Then, the following week, at the start of the show, just tweet at Funky Roller Rink the results of the hip-hop set list in the order they were played. The first three skaters with the correct set list will win some free threads, baby. But you gotta watch the show to win. It's the Sample My Funk t-shirt contest this week on the Funky Roller Rink. Check out the Funky Roller Rink blog on 420radio.org for more info. And as always, keep it funky, keep it funky, keep it funky.
I'm Sub Cool from Team Green Avenger. At TGAGenetics.com, we are working on the leading edge of medical strains. Our strains are rigorously tested for THC, CBD, THCV, and other critical cannabinoids. Know your grow. Check out our genetic diversity at TGAGenetics.com, the home of Jelly Bean, Jack the Ripper, Vortex, and other award-winning cannabis strains.
Welcome back, everybody. That's Musicien Sans Frontières with Picture from our daily Toker Tunes library. Welcome back. It's Toker Talk Radio. The phone lines are open at 971-533-7111. We're still reacting to the shocking news out of Boston, Massachusetts, where two explosions have killed two and injured 110 at the finish line of the Boston Marathon. Reports from Fox News say the explosive devices were loaded with ball bearings, kind of like Claymore mines to inflict human damage there. No one has any idea why these were planted, who planted them, what the point was behind them. You can't really understand the mind of a madman, but I have to wonder how desperate we allow people to get in this country and how much effect that might have on a lot of things that go on here in America. You know, since Newtown, the debate's all been about the gun control, gun rights, gun magazines, gun safety checks. I saw a stat the other day. The surveys had shown that gun background checks were more popular than kittens. Like 90% of America supports universal gun background checks. And yet our system, our political system is now, set to reject even that one small measure. Hey, before we sell someone a gun, maybe we ought to check and see if they're a nut. Nope. Can't even go with that. So we've been debating, for the longest time, these gun measures. Now we have this terrorist, what appears to be some sort of terrorist type of attack, whether it's coordinated by an actual terrorist group or just a lone nut who wanted to terrorize people for whatever reason. And this is not a unique phenomenon to America, of course. The rest of the world is kind of like, hey, welcome. Welcome to what we've been dealing with for a while. But you have to wonder how much of this just gets to the point where we put people in situations where, they have no safety net. They got nothing left to lose. We put people in situations that result in insane behavior. We did the story on Joshua Hacken, the man who stole his own kids back, after a pot bust. And I, regardless of the crazy that he exhibited, that I definitely don't agree with, threatening people with weapons and so forth, kidnapping and so forth, you have to ask, how much of that was born from putting this guy in an impossible situation? How much of our massive, outlier in the world where we have 10,000, gun deaths compared to, other countries, if they have 100, it's amazing. How much of that is part of our dog-eat-dog, hyper-competitive, always ranking against each other in terms of wealth and attractiveness and power and status and for a supposedly a Christian nation? Just amazing. And how much of this owes to just our nature as Americans? I forget the exact stat, but it's a large majority of all military expenditure in the world is American. We have more spending on defense than the next 26 countries, as much as the next 26 countries combined, and 24 of those countries are our allies. How much of these type of day-to-day events, this day-to-day reaction from the Joshua Hackens or whoever bombed Boston today, how many of these things just come from us not caring about each other? I end the show every day with "take care of each other, Tokers," and it's a nice little tagline, but I really begin to think more and more about this, is that that's our number one issue here, is not giving a shit about each other, not taking care of each other, not seeing each other as ourselves. I get all, Christian on you or whatever, but how much of this is not, treating your neighbor as you would want to be treated? I don't know. I don't have any solutions for this. I can't help but think also that, a world with legal marijuana is a little nicer world, perhaps. Maybe some of these people that are stressed out get a little natural stress relief. I don't know. It's a stretch, maybe. But I don't know how to make sense of these kind of things. That's why I look at look out for what you guys have to say about it. It's just tough. Some practical advice. Let me throw some practical stuff out. If you have friends or family in the Boston area and you're worried about them, don't clog up the cell phone line networks right now. Don't try to call them on a cell phone. Text message is a much better idea. Text message, far less bandwidth, is what I'm reading. Of course, giving blood is always good in a situation like this, especially if you're in the Northeast corridor, in that Northeast area. See about getting in touch with the Red Cross, give blood in a situation like this. Checking up with folks in the chat room. We've got almost 50s in the chat. Bong Hitter, Canadad, Jam Band Fan. Nice to see you all. I didn't start up the video chat today. Sorry, I got a little behind. I was, you know, so paying attention to the news today that didn't know what to do there. Mighty Mike, welcome to the show. Let me get back to some marijuana news. The 420 Times, if you know about the magazine, the 420 Times, they are coming out with a 3D edition for the 420, for their 420 edition. It'll come with a pair of 3D glasses and have all sorts of great pop porn, macro photography, all the way to extreme close-ups of plants taken under an electron microscope. Also, some of the ads will be in 3D as well. So check that out. Dave Bryan, the editor of the 420 Times, says, 420 has always been a very special day for our readers. Even though it's a day for people to celebrate the progress medical marijuana and legalization efforts have made recently, this year it's about to get a little more trippy. You can pick 420 Times up in mostly in Southern California, or check out 420, the420times.com. That's news from Huffington Post. I appreciate that people like pop porn pictures. I think it's kind of silly sometimes. But I appreciate it. I mean, marijuana is obviously a beautiful plant, beautiful flower and all that. But it don't you think it is a little silly having centerfolds of pot plants? Eh, maybe not. I guess just, you know, it's appreciation, right? I think it's funny how the outside looks at it, though. Like, you know, as if we'd be whacking off to pot pictures or something. Anyway, just think it's silly. Let's see. Also, Boston Police Department has a tip line up available for their task force. I'm going to post this in the chat room while we're sitting here. But this is the Boston Police Department line. And... All right, so a little 10-foot ganja plant, lighten things up a little bit here. When we come back from our break, we'll have plenty more here on Toker Talk Radio. Catch you up with some of the marijuana stories. I'm going to finish up the rant from that new Project Sam fella. Also, coming up this week, all sorts of great guests. You'll want to stay tuned for tomorrow's show. We have got... Across the Pond with Normal UK. We'll see if we get Greg DeHote on the line. On Wednesday, Dr. Mitch and John Payne from Show Me Cannabis Regulation in Missouri. So we'll have two guests on Wednesday. And on Thursday, we've got two guests as well. We've got Cops Say Legalized Drugs Leap segment with James Gerak joining us again. And we'll follow that up on Thursday with Mike G from High Times Magazine, web editor. He's going to give us a preview of 420. Talk about that when we come back, too.
Oh, have you ever met that funny reefer man? A reefer man. Have you ever met that funny reefer man? A reefer man. If he said he swam to China, he would sell you South Carolina. Then you know you're talking to that reefer man.
Wood Pipes Smoke Shop and Speakeasy is your source for cannabis community gear in southern Wisconsin. Owners Brian and Tammy Wood are located in Kendall, just outside of Madison, and they've got everything for the smoking enthusiast, including a full assortment of pipes, water pipes, hookahs, bubblers, one-hitters, and so much more. They're open noon to 8 p.m. Monday through Saturday and can help you with your detoxification therapies as well. Call 608-466-7473 or email woodpipes@yahoo.com for more information. That's 608-466-7473 or email woodpipes@yahoo.com. And as always, go Pack, go!
Welcome back, everybody. Toker Talk Radio, 21 after the hour. I just posted a link to Twitter, although that's one of those secure links, so let me see if I can get you a better one. Secure links don't quick so well, so I'll give you a bit.ly for it. Here we go. So here, if you'll check this link, the Rad Russ link that I'm posting right now, that is a link to a photo of New Magazine. Or actually, it's New Magazine, because it's got an exclamation point. So the photo there in New Magazine is, I give my 7-year-old cannabis. Erin Purchase tells New she uses the drug to ease the symptoms of her daughter's leukemia treatment. So our very own brave Michaela, some beautiful photos of Michaela with some with a nice plant, actually. Sister Riley as well, Erin Purchase, and Brandon Krenzler there in a little inset photo. So check that out and pass that around with your Twitter circles, because this kind of media coverage here, and big thanks to Canadad, at Canadad on Twitter, to get more information. But yeah, as these stories go across, it's harder and harder for them to fight us, which brings me back to the post by Ron Nehring out there on Huffington Post, because this is part of his thesis here is that we're fooling people. That's it. We're fooling people about marijuana. They can't figure it out for themselves. It's all a bunch of marketing. I kid you not, people. This guy says it's about marketing. He has that one line, Project Sam is a response to the lavishly funded efforts by George Soros, Peter Lewis, John Sperling, to expand marijuana use by redefining the drug as medicine. Redefining marijuana as medicine. No, no. We are just returning to the original definition. That's all. Cannabis has been medicine dating back to 2700 BC. Cannabis has been used as medicine by people on every continent outside of the Arctic Circle and Antarctic Circle. Cannabis was in the U.S. pharmacopoeia until 1942 as medicine. We're not redefining marijuana as medicine. We're redefining it back to its original definition and away from the propaganda definition that has been given to us since the 1930s. So, yeah, he says it's a lavishly funded effort. He says that yet through persistent marketing, marijuana's advocates have succeeded in creating just enough myth and confusion about the drug's health benefits, in scare quotes, that has shifted public opinion in some quarters toward legalization. This has been their intention all along. Persistent marketing. You know, like this news story where they talk about a 7-year-old girl who has leukemia and uses cannabis oil and it helps. See, that would be marketing, right? Telling the truth about what it's doing, that's our persistent marketing. So let me give you some other points that he makes in here that are just ridiculous. He comes back with, you know, today's marijuana is 5 to 6 times stronger than it was in the 60s and 70s. Well, we couldn't test THC potency in the 60s because we didn't even know what the hell THC was in the 60s. It was 64, Raphael Mechoulam finally identified it. Ability to test for its potency didn't come along until the 70s. And then what they were testing in the 60s and 70s was often the swag that they had built up at the evidence locker that had been sitting in a hot, dry locker for years and had lost a lot of its potency. there's always been strong potency marijuana. There's always been Maui Wowie, Acapulco Gold, Panama Red, Thai Stick, etc. Ask any of the folks that were smoking weed back then. They'll tell you there was good weed back then, and there was bad weed back then. There's bad weed now. You can find some pretty swaggy weed. You head to the American Southwest, you head to the American South, some of that Mexican brick coming up, some pretty swaggy stuff. What has changed, the average potency of seizures, it's gone from about 4% to about 10%. So yeah, it's about 2.5 times stronger. But the problem is, that doesn't mean anything. He comes apart and says, today's marijuana is more powerful, more addictive, and causes more mental and physical damage than ever before because it's 5 to 6 times stronger, right? Where is any evidence or proof behind this kind of statement? See, marijuana, at a certain potency, does not make you any more chance of getting addicted or bad harms coming to you. This would be like saying, well, if you don't want to be an alcoholic, drink beer. Because if you drink tequila, why, it's more potent, and you'll be more likely to become addicted. That's not the way marijuana, it's not the way alcohol works, much less the way marijuana works. There's plenty of people that have become alcoholics from drinking beer. The potency of the alcohol doesn't matter. But potency of alcohol does matter in one respect. You drink a quart of beer, you're probably going to get a buzz. You drink a quart of Bacardi 151, you're probably going to die. That difference does not exist with marijuana. With marijuana, you smoke some swaggy weed, you smoke a lot of it, you get high. You smoke some really potent weed, you smoke a little of it, and you get high. Earlier in the show, I was doing some dab, I was doing some concentrate, you know, some wax, some of this stuff, just concentrated marijuana. Far more potent than what would be in a flower. But if I was smoking a flower, I'd smoke an entire joint. Smoking this, I can smoke a little tiny bit of it. Achieve the same result. With less smoke, for that matter. This potency argument is such a red herring. It is so ridiculous. Marijuana is non-toxic. And you cannot float the potency argument at us when Marinol, dronabinol, is a 100% potent synthetic THC suspended in a sesame oil capsule. If the potency were a big problem, wouldn't it be a bigger problem with the Marinol? It is, but I'll save that for another rant. He also says in this piece on Huffington Post, this is Ron Nehring, by the way, although often mocked by pro-marijuana advocates, Nancy Reagan's 1980s Just Say No campaign proved extremely effective in reminding parents and children alike of how to respond to opportunities to take drugs. This is one of those correlation causation things. These guys like to look at the stats of reported marijuana use throughout the 1980s and show, like, wow, what an amazing drop there was. And it's true. You look at some of the national survey stuff and you will see drops in the reported use of marijuana and other drugs from 1980 to about 1992. Reported use of drugs. If your government is coming out on a day-to-day basis and saying, just say no, drugs are evil, drugs are the cause of terrorism, drugs are the cause of crime, people that use drugs are losers, users are losers. I remember all the lines that I heard when I was growing up in the 1980s. If you get that constant refrain that your use of drugs makes you subhuman and a second-class citizen and evil, and then the government calls you on the phone with a random pollster and says, do you smoke marijuana? What's your answer more likely to be? Of course, the reported rates dropped during the 1980s because we underwent the age of Reagan and Just Say No and everybody being afraid and terrorized by this idea that drug use was, you know, the crack babies were going to take over and so forth. Were there fewer? Maybe there were fewer viewers. Maybe there won't. But I don't trust much with respect to these polls so long as admitting to using marijuana brands you a criminal. What else he got in here? He says, smoked cannabis, it turns out, is not medicine. We don't need to derive whatever therapeutic benefit it might have by smoking it any more than we need to smoke opium to get the effects of morphine. It's the smoking, folks. These people hate the smoking. It's really as simple as that. They just hate the smoking part of it. But in this statement, he admits marijuana's medicine. Whatever therapeutic benefit it might have, we don't need to derive any therapeutic benefit it might have, tells us that you recognize there is a therapeutic benefit from it. That people, they're not faking it. They're not engaged in marketing. People in pain, people with spasticity, people with seizures are actually really benefiting from this. And you're saying, oh, well, we don't need to smoke it any more than we have to smoke opium to get morphine. Okay. But you do believe morphine's a medicine, right? And that smoking opium could give you a benefit like morphine, right? So smoking marijuana in this little analogy would give you a therapeutic benefit, wouldn't it? Now, indeed, we might be able to take the marijuana plant and extract this cannabinoid and this terpene and that flavonoid and put them together in a pill or a spray or an inhaler and make ourselves one hell of a fine pharmaceutical. And I really got no problem with that. But you can't tell us that using the smoked plant isn't giving a benefit if you're taking ingredients from the smoked plant and making something beneficial from them. So given that the smoked plant you are admitting is a type of medicine, maybe not as good as the one you could make in a lab, but it is still some sort of medicine. The question is, why would we arrest and imprison people who use the less effective drug? Is that the rule, that the drug has to be the most effective drug possible? You can't use a natural substitute that might be 85% as effective. We have to use the one that has a barcode. We have to use the one that's owned by a corporation. We have to use the one that has a 15,000% markup. Yeah, that's really what it's coming down to, isn't it? He also points out the old IQ thing, right? That study, that's, they're all just slavering over this study that supposedly shows if you smoked a lot of pot before age 15, by the time you hit age 38, you lose 8 points of IQ. Well, I'm against people smoking a lot of weed by the age of 15. So let's card them. How about we check their IDs? How about we make it something only adults are allowed to do? Because as I showed in those stats earlier on the rant, if people start smoking marijuana after the age of 18, we find a 9.5% of them become monthly smokers. We find for most people that start later in life, it's not a big deal. It's a casual, every now and then social kind of thing. So what these people, what these Ron Nehrings of the world seem to be saying is, even though you adults can handle it, even though it doesn't seem to addict you adults, even though it doesn't seem to be much of a problem in your life, we can't let you do that because it might be a problem for 1 out of 6 people that try it before the age of 17. We cannot allow you to have this freedom as an adult because of the danger to the children who aren't allowed to use it anyway. And you have to wonder, why, where is this logic with alcohol? Where is this logic with tobacco? My God, tobacco in a lot of states is, you can purchase it at age 18. So where is the logic? We know that it kills the adults who use it. And yet we'll let, at age 18, young people smoke tobacco. When we know that it addicts more than 1 out of 6 of them, it addicts 1 out of 3 of anybody who tries it of any age. So where's this logic with tobacco? And yet, for these people, it always comes back to, well, it's too late with tobacco. It's too late with alcohol. They've got entrenched big tobacco. They've got entrenched alcohol industry. There's too much culture behind it. Yada, yada, yada. It always has to do with, there's too many people doing it. There's too many big businesses supporting it. And it's too culturally ingrained. Well, how long do we have to wait for marijuana? Been smoking pot since a long time. 1900s? There's big business behind it now. And 420 ought to prove that there's some culture behind it.
We'll be right back after these messages from our 420 friendly sponsors. Support these advertisers because their ad money goes straight to the Russ Belville Show. You're tuned into the Russ Belville Show, the voice of the marijuana nation.
Cast your eyes up to the skies. What is it to live and die?
The High Times Cannabis Cup in Amsterdam is recognized as the world's premier marijuana competition. Over the years, thousands of judges have attended the Cannabis Cup, sampling the best indicas, best sativas, best hybrids, and the best hash on the planet. In the April 2013 issue of High Times, read all about the sensational 25th Cannabis Cup that took place in November. Find out about the latest killer strains. Decide what to grow in your garden this year. Celebrate 25 years of the Cannabis Cup in this very special issue of High Times magazine. On sale now.
I like that.
Well, I don't know what you can do, but what we can keep walking
alive. That's right, baby. We're keeping the funk alive right here at Big Daddy Fink's Funky Roller Ring, your groovy home of soul, funk, and disco. So join me, Big Daddy, every Thursday night, 11 Eastern, 8 Pacific, at the Funky Roller Ring, where every night is Saturday night.
Stars with Swagger. That's local Portland funk, folks. Loving that. Welcome back. Toker Talk Radio, 971-533-7111. Just chilling out here in that. I'll be damned if that's never going to play again, is it? This is the weirdest thing. All right. Let's see if other songs will play. I'm having some problems with some of the automation software here, so give me just a moment. Here we go. Now it's time for Raid of the Day. Raid of the Day features stories collected by Radley Balco, writing for The Agitator at HuffingtonPost.com for his upcoming book, Rise of the Warrior Cop. On January 3rd, 2001, Jerome County, Idaho Sheriff's Deputies James Molson and Philip Anderson conducted a drug raid on the Eden home of George Timothy Williams, a man described by an informant as one of the leading suppliers of marijuana in the county. Jerome County Sheriff Jim Weaver and Undersheriff Jocelyn Nunnally also went on the raid. It's unclear if they announced themselves before entering. The surviving officers say they did, but Williams' neighbors said they heard no announcement. But when Anderson and Molson forced their way inside, Williams met them with a gun. The three men exchanged gunfire. All three of them died. A subsequent search of the home turned up less than 4 grams of marijuana. Lawsuits brought by the families of the slain deputies and by Williams' family revealed that the informant whose tip led to the raid was a woman who lived with Williams, and alleged that the sheriff's department threatened to take the woman's child away from her if she didn't give them incriminating information about Williams. The county settled with the families of the slain deputies. The lawsuit brought by Williams' family was dismissed in federal court. A subsequent investigation by the Idaho State Police found no criminal wrongdoing on the part of the Sheriff's Department or the deputies who conducted the raid. Sheriff Jim Weaver's aggressive anti-drug policing later made him subject to a recall campaign that was unsuccessful. The shootout also became a central issue in his 2004 re-election campaign. In 2007, Molson, Anderson, and Nanalli were awarded Idaho's Medal of Honor for their actions on the night of the raid. This has been your Raid of the Day from Rise of the Warrior Cop, the militarization of America's police forces. It's due out in July, but you can pre-order it from Amazon. Raid of the Day. Theme from SWAT, by the way. For you youngsters out there, we used to have a TV show back in the 70s called SWAT. Or was it the 80s? Was it the 80s? How old am I? Anyway, there used to be a show called SWAT. And back in the day, this was kind of a new thing, right? The idea of having a special military tactics force that went in to go get the bad guys, the big dangerous bad guys, was kind of new. And exciting. And the idea that, you know, finally we're going to get tough on crime. You know, there was a big throughout the 70s. Everybody's all afraid of crime. And SWAT was glorified. Robert Urich start on SWAT? I think he did. But it was such a big glory deal. And now, oh, here we go. 1975 to 1976. Thank you, Trickster. It was the 70s. I was right. I was a little kid. I remember it. But now it's cops, and it's almost become like the whole SWAT show, you know, is a weekly serial kind of thing, weekly drama, right? Now it's like every day, like trying to make a show out of SWAT, and they've got one on. I think it's on like one of those Ion Television channels or something like that, Standoff or Flashpoint or some name like that. But on these shows, even the modern ones, SWAT is depicted as, you know, going after the really bad, dangerous guys. You know, there's a guy who's held up a bank and he's got, you know, all these weapons and 30 hostages. And I think we all agree that's what we want SWAT for, right? Guys hold up in a bank with 30 hostages. Yeah, let's call in the SWAT. But what SWAT never showed you back in the day, and what, you know, Flashpoint and Cops, well, I guess Cops does to some extent, is the fact that we're using SWAT to serve raids on nonviolent drug offenders. Where even if you, like, you know, the story we just told, you know, they just only found 4 grams of marijuana. But let's say they found what they were looking for. Let's say they were, you know, thinking this guy was one of the biggest, you know, marijuana suppliers in Idaho, and they get to his place and they find a barn with 800 plants. Is that still worth, you know, shooting up places and coming in with guns drawn and risking all that life and doing all this, you know, all these raids? Does not seem right to me at all. All right. Let's see here. I had another story that I wanted to get to. Oh, yeah. I wanted to come back to Ron Nehring for a little bit because there's a few more bits of reefer madness that he left in there that must be addressed. He says that marijuana use has been linked to a greater likelihood of abuse of other drugs in the future. Yeah, the old gateway theory, folks. It's the old gateway theory. If you use marijuana, there's a greater likelihood you will abuse other drugs in the future. Well, we've talked about this before. The gateway that exists is the gateway to being illegal. That's the gateway that exists. Portugal, Netherlands, lots of places have discovered that when you separate the market for soft drugs and the market for hard drugs, that gateway, any gateway there might be, starts to close up. But marijuana being a gateway drug, whenever someone tells you that, they're looking through the wrong end of the binoculars. They got the binoculars backwards. And here's what I mean. They're looking at the guy who's a heroin addict, and they're asking the heroin addict, what was the first drug you ever did? And they all say marijuana. Oh, see? every heroin addict we ever talked to, the first drug they ever did was marijuana.
You're looking through it the wrong direction. Ask marijuana smokers how many of them have smoked heroin or shot heroin or done heroin, whatever. That's the way you look at it. For every 108 people who try marijuana, one of them goes on to use some other illicit drug. Most people that smoke pot, that's their terminus drug. That's where they stop with their drug taking. They get to pot and they go, oh, well, this is nice. And that's about it. And some who get to pot, especially if they get to it younger, they'll get to pot and they'll realize, oh, well, this is not so bad. This is all right. And since they've been told it was drugs and it's been put in this big bin with drugs and drugs are bad, okay, when they discover pot's not a big deal and that their friends are smoking pot and they all seem to be okay and nobody's having some weird problems and, oh, so that's drugs, huh? And when other opportunities come up to try cocaine or meth or ecstasy or mushrooms or whatever might be floating around, the mind goes back to, oh, well, yeah, drugs. They told me pot was bad. They told me it was a drug and it was bad. They lied about that. Let's see what these other ones are like. And even with that part of the gateway, some of those people who experiment with those other drugs, who've tried marijuana and then experiment with those other drugs, come to realize that, oh, wait, these drugs are actually drugs. These drugs are actually a bad deal. I'll stop doing these drugs. And many of them stop doing those drugs thanks to marijuana. So that's something that has to be considered when you're making this debate. The gateway, any gateway that might exist, is partially economic. You know, you're putting people in the same market as other drugs. People that want to get weed have to get it on the illegal market where all the drugs are. A lot of people, if they could get weed at the weed store, wouldn't go on to ever have any exposure to any other drug. So part of it's economic, and part of it's propaganda. Part of it is, yeah, you lied to me about this one, so you must have been lying to me about the other ones. Here's a statement from, again, this is the Ron Nehring thing. Here's the statement that this will blow your mind. Project Sam embraces smart reform of marijuana laws by dealing with use as a health problem while keeping it out of the hands of potential new users by maintaining its prohibition. Let's think about that. Think about that for a second. If prohibition were keeping drugs out of the hands of potential new users, we wouldn't be having this discussion. Prohibition is doing nothing to keep drugs out of the hands of potential new users. I mean, I've talked to Leap guys. I love it when they say this. They say, hey, if prohibition was working, I'd be the first one behind it. But it's not. Prohibition does nothing to keep it out of the hands of potential new users. These Sam guys, they seem to be of this attitude that, well, somewhere along the line, you did drugs. And so now that you have done them, we'll treat it like it's a public health issue and we'll get you treatment now that you've done drugs. But they aren't willing to accept that to have gotten to the point where you need to be a public health problem, at some point you had to have done drugs the first time, and that's where the prohibition kicks in and starts arresting people and putting them away. Now they would just, and I've heard this from in many different forms. They seem to have an attitude that if you want to do drugs, as long as you're a hermit, you know, lock yourself in a cave, have no outside exposure to the world whatsoever, they're okay with you doing drugs. Now, never mind how you're supposed to get them without, you know, being arrested or anything. But I've heard McCaffrey tell me that I can have 40 giant pot plants, or I can have a dozen giant pot plants out at my log cabin. I've heard Kevin Sabet say, well, bless you. If you don't want to drive my car or drive my bus or drive my kids, that's fine. Go ahead, knock yourself out. So they really just seem to have a problem with allowing us to do that. On the one hand, they'll say it's okay if you're doing it and you're all alone, but how in the hell are we supposed to get it? Why do they want us to get our marijuana from unsafe, untested criminal sources? They seem to not have a problem with us once we get it, And so long as we don't get caught with it. But this is that attitude of all use is abuse. Nobody can ever use marijuana responsibly. Anything you do is abuse every time. And that's where we have the problem. They can't acknowledge that some people smoke pot and nothing bad comes from their pot smoking. That's what they can't get their mind around. And it really has a lot to do with whether or not they think it's going to be acceptable, an acceptable social thing. It's so much about culture war. This is really what it's all about. It's all about culture war, people. We'll wind the show up today talking a little bit more about that when we come back.
We'll be right back after these messages from our 420 friendly sponsors. Support these advertisers because their ad money goes straight to the Russ Belville Show. You're tuned into the Russ Belville Show, the voice of the marijuana nation.
Cast your eyes up to the skies. What is it to live and die?
The man that smokes that jab will take you for a dive. Wonders if he's still alive. When you smoke that killing jab, it will make you very tall. It seems as if you're going to fall. Knock yourself just up on fire. You know I mean that killing jab. You only think you've blown your time. Oh, baby, you start laughing and you can't stop. Then you don't give a whop, cause you said, man, not bent, man. Everything will seem so funny, darkest days will seem so sunny. Yes, the feeling will arrive when you smoke that killing jive. Yeah, yeah. Does he smoke that killing jive? Yes, he smokes that killing
Oh, that's Killin' Jive from Cats and the Fiddle.
That's the name of that group.
Some of the kind of music we play on our Reefer Madness. I'm sorry, our Viper Hour. I'm getting myself all confused. That we play on the Viper Hour every Monday night at 8 o'clock. But this Monday night, we've got more of our Reefer Movie Madness that we're putting on, where we show movies from the 1930s, these old, you know, Protect Your Daughters and Watch Out for the Weed and Reefer Madness and Assassin of Youth. I'll put some of these up on the screen for you. These are some of the old-time movie posters. Tonight, we're going to be showing the movie She Should Have Said No. Not exactly what She Should Have Said No To. That'll be part of our Reefer Movie Madness tonight at 8 o'clock Pacific Time here on 420radio.org. Welcome back to Toker Talk Radio. Phone lines are open at 971-533-7111. Want to encourage folks to stay tuned tonight. Coming up next in about 5 minutes, Herb Thrasher Flower Hour from last Friday. Great show with Herb Thrasher. So check that out. I'm going to go back here and find our special guest on the Herb Show, if I recall right. Yes. Oh, not special guest, but a special band. The Pine Box Boys. So you're going to get some of that hard-edged country stuff that Herb likes, that that hellbilly music on tonight's Herb Thrasher. Coming up, like I said, in just about 5 minutes, top of this next hour. And 8 o'clock tonight, the Reefer Movie Madness, like I mentioned. Okay, so this weekend, 420, I hope you all have something exciting planned for your 420. I'm going to be in Denver, Colorado. I arrive Friday at 8:45 p.m. I'm going to miss the Snoop Dogg thing, but I sold my ticket to Bago Schwago, so he's going to go for us and report back to us. Then Saturday, the Cannabis Cup begins. I think the doors open at 8 o'clock for those of us who are the vendors. So anybody listening who's on the vending team, who's on my vendor team, I'll probably be there as early as possible. I like to get there as early as I can. So probably 8 a.m. I'll be there, or 9. I forget when it opens, but I think it's 8. The doors open at noon for the public, and that's when we'll go live at right here at 420 Radio and the Russ Belville Show. It might be audio only. I'm going to go live with whatever I have the most bandwidth to do. We've tried video in the past, and sometimes I can do video with a lower definition screen, and that might be what we end up doing. But we're going to do 420 Radio. I've got some new stuff showing up there. I've just ordered today 1,000 420 Radio stickers and 1,000 Russ Belville Show stickers, and we are going to sell as many of those as we can in Denver, and the rest of them we'll bring back and put for sale in our store, and we'll mail them out to our VIP members for free too. You'll all get your own sticker. That's coming up coming up soon. I got to get all those prizes mailed out for our VIP members. And speaking of, please, if you can, help support us here at 420radio.org by becoming a VIP member. We've got a bronze membership. It only costs you $4.20 a month. And for $4.20 a month, you're getting 16 hours of new content every week. So what's that? 64 hours of content a month for $4.20. That's the best deal anywhere. And those little contributions, they all add up to keeping us on the air as independent marijuana media. And I think this is so important. We are not beholden to the nonprofit agendas of Normal or Leap or MPP. If they do something deserving of criticism, we can criticize it right here on 420 Radio. We don't have to depend on them for a paycheck. Likewise, we're not dependent on any one particular vendor of any one particular product. Because we have the support of our listeners, the only people we have to please is you. That's the only person we have to please is you. And if you want to keep us on the air, $4.20 a month will do a whole lot of good toward keeping us on the air. We're going to be going through some changes in the next couple of months. A move to a new studio in Astoria. Got a whole bunch of events. I'll be on tour with the FNAs starting in June, going around the South Central United States, Texas, Oklahoma, New Mexico. Hope to meet a lot of friends and fans out there. That's about all the time we got here for Hour 2, Toker Talk Radio. But again, thank you for joining us. And like I said, Brian the Red will be back tomorrow with and so will I, with more news and interviews that you can use for the cannabis community right here at the Russ Belville Show, Toker Talk Radio, and 420radio.org. Please tell your friends. Stay tuned. Herb Thrasher is next. We're back with Reefer Movie Madness at 8 o'clock tonight. And until next time, take care of each other, Tokers.
This is the Russ Belville Show. The Russ Belville Show is blogging and podcasting daily at RadicalRuss.com.
Take a seed, you plant it, you grow it, you try it, you roll it, you smoke it. You take a seed, you plant it, you grow it, you try it, you roll it, you smoke it. You take a seed, you plant it, you grow it, you try it, you roll it, you smoke it, and it goes down smooth.
What's happening, funky brothers and souls?